Hi, thanks for joining us today. If this ministry has impacted your life, we want to hear about it. You can send us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. Also, we would love if you would partner with us financially. You can go to vineyardchurch.com and click the Give Online or text your donation amount to 757-230-2110.
To honor copyright laws, we have removed some audio and video elements from this message. Now here's this week's message.
The Son's dying words to the world, words spoken through pain and great suffering, with passionate love to the ones He was dying to save, are the sum of His life and works, His gift to us, His heart, and the sound bites of God.
Well, good morning. How are you? We are in part two of a series we started last week called Sound Bites. Now, all over the world, we're starting at the beginning of Lent, and all over the world, the church recognizes Lent as a time to kind of prepare yourself spiritually, mentally, emotionally, thinking about what Christ did for us on the cross and then at Easter. And so for many people during Lent, that's a time where they're kind of examining themselves and thinking about what, you know, preparing themselves spiritually for what Christ did and what He can do in our lives. And that's kind of the idea behind this series on sound bites. The sound bites is the seven statements Jesus said from the cross. I don't know if you knew that. He had said seven statements. They're small, but they're very impactful, very powerful. And so we wanted to take this time of Lent and look at each one of those statements. And even though it's short, just say, how does this apply to me? What can I gain from this? And so we're looking at that. That's the nature of what we're doing. So last week, of course, we started with the theme of forgiveness. Jesus said, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And then this week, we're going to begin with this new part, what I'm calling what God expects from you. Now, if you have your Bibles, open those up to Luke 23. Of course, it's on your outline on the side screens. It says, two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. So Jesus is taken out of the city of Jerusalem and taken to this place outside the city where they were going to execute him. They were going to crucify him on a place called the Skull. Now, it's likely that it was called the Skull because it was a place that looked like a skull. When I was in high school, we used to go backpacking out in Arizona, and one of the places I went to was called Manhead, and it was called Manhead because it looked like a man's head. And you had to use a little imagination, but we used to like to scurry up to the top and have lunch, and it was a huge, huge stone. Well, this would have been the same kind of thing, where it's the skull, the place of the skull. Now, if you look in Matthew and Mark, that when it's talking about this where he was crucified, they refer to it as Golgotha. That's the Aramaic word for the skull, right? That's what it is. And in Luke and John, he just calls it, he says, it's, you know, in the Greek, it's actually the word cranium, which is where we get our word today, cranium, which means skull. And you may have heard of Calvary. That's when the King James is translated, they pulled not from the Greek, but from the Latin Vulgate in this case, which is because the Latin word is Calvaria, which means skull. And so that's where you've probably heard Calvary. But they're all referring to the same place. Golgotha, Calvary, they all mean the place of the skull. So this is where Jesus was crucified. And crucifixion was created in Carthage in about 400 BC. They were trying to come up with a more extreme way to kill somebody. At the time, they were just beheading people. They thought, that's too merciful. We're just cutting their head off. They just die too quick. And so they came up with this idea of crucifixion. And crucifixion was a more prolonged way of torturing somebody before they die. Archaeologists have learned over the last several years more about crucifixion as they uncovered things. About 50 years ago, they uncovered the only known skeleton who was crucified. And this guy was crucified in around the first century. And what they found that was interesting to them that they didn't know was that the nail went through his heel sideways. So what that meant was is that somebody was crucified with their torso forward, but then their legs kind of cropped up and bent at the waist at a 90 degree, and then the nail went through their heel. And so that's a very uncomfortable. So that abnormal position, as well as extreme thirst, muscle spasms, blood loss, the weather, all those things going into the prolonged way of dying in this torturous way. So it's kind of remarkable that if you think about it being such an excruciating way to die, that people today like to use it as a piece of jewelry, you know, like a little cross. You know, probably a lot of Sharon wears a cross. But in the first century, they would not wear a cross because it would be like, it'd be like wearing a little electric chair or something. You know, you can buy those. I looked it up on eBay, and here it is. If you want to get one, it's about the size of a penny. And here, look at the next picture. So it's kind of, so you know, if you got it, it's got a little cap for the head. And then the little necklace part goes back and actually has like a little plug that you would like plug in to give you some juice. Now, who would wear that, right? I mean, I don't see these going like a hotcake, right? I mean, there's just, people look at you, what's your problem? Or do you have issues, right? Because a cross was not a nice, kind, delicate little symbol. It represented the most excruciating way for somebody to die. And here, I want to read to you just a portion from a 1986 article on crucifixion of Jesus from the Journal of American Medical Association. Said this, quote, "The procedure of crucifixion may be summarized as follows. The cross was put on the ground and the victim laid upon it. Nails about 7 inches long with a diameter of 1 centimeter were driven into the wrists. The points would go into the vicinity of the median nerve, causing shocks of pain to radiate through the arms. It was possible to place the nails between the bones so that no fractures occurred. Studies have shown that nails were probably driven through the small bones of the wrists, since nails in the palms of the hands would not support the weight of the body. In ancient terminology, the wrist was considered to be part of the hand. The feet were nailed to the cross to allow for this. The knees had to be bent and rotated laterally, being left in a very uncomfortable position. When the cross was erected upright, there was tremendous strain put on the wrists, arms, and shoulders, resulting in a dislocation of the shoulder and elbow joints. The arms, being held up and outward, held the rib cage in a position which made it very extremely difficult to exhale and impossible to take a full breath. The victim would only be able to take very shallow breaths." This would probably be why Jesus said just short phrases. "As time passed, the muscles from the loss of blood, lack of oxygen, and fixed position of the body would undergo severe cramps and spasmodic contractions." So this is the image we really need to have in mind when we're reading these passages. This is what's going on. These are why the phrases are short. Jesus is being crucified. This place of the skull, a place outside the city, a place that's very desolate, a place for executions. And he wasn't alone. There was two other crosses crucified right next to him. One on his left, one on his right. Both were criminals. That was for a reason. The authorities wanted to make it look like Jesus was guilty. He wasn't guilty, but it was almost like guilt by association. 700 years earlier, Isaiah prophesied this would happen to the Messiah, so that he would be numbered among the transgressors. So three crosses. Three things we can learn from those crosses. Number one, the first cross was really a cross of rejection. These guys weren't like good guys, which, you know, were first-time offenders. They were murderers. They were also thieves. We would call them today like muggers. This is the word that's referred to when they're talking about criminals. Is the same word Jesus uses when he's talking about the Good Samaritan. That story in the Good Samaritan. Some travelers walking down on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho, and some muggers come. They not only rob him, but they beat him to where he almost dies. That's the same word. This is the same word that's referred to Barabbas. Barabbas was an insurrectionist. He was a murderer. He was in custody. And there's two other guys in custody with him. He's released in place of Jesus, and then these other two guys that were in custody for the same crimes were crucified along with Jesus. So this idea of guilt by association, and this guy hears the chanting of the crowd saying insults to Jesus, and he just jumps right in. He says, one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him, referring to Jesus. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. So this criminal, he just picks right up. He starts insulting him. Now, this word insult is the same word for blasphemy. He just says blasphemies to him. What is a blasphemy? It's when we don't take Jesus seriously. When we don't take who he is seriously and his power seriously. And he just insults him. And he says, you know, if you're really the Messiah, he doesn't believe he's the Messiah. He wants to get down from the cross, but he doesn't believe Jesus is who he said he is. So this guy, it's remarkable that this guy is only a few feet away. He's in his dying moments. He's in his moment of greatest need, and yet he still won't accept Christ. He won't put his faith in the Messiah. People do that today, you know. People will be in a place of great need. They might be in their dying moments and they refuse to bow their knee to God's Son. It's pride. It's just, they just hold up, I'm going to do this on my own. You know, no matter how bad it gets. And so this guy, here he is. He's so close to somebody who really could help him, but he holds him at a distance. So it's really the cross of rejection. Cross of saying, you know what? You know, it didn't even occur to him to repent, to change his mind, to soften a little bit, to humble himself, to put away the excuses, the conditions, all those things, and just say, you know what, and throw himself at the mercy of God. Then you have another cross, the cross of repentance. So this guy's a different, you know, same, interesting, because they're both criminals. This guy takes a different approach. He hears the taunting of this other criminal, and this guy rebukes the criminal who's insulting Jesus. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you're under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. He says, I'm guilty, and I know it, and you're guilty, but this guy is innocent. See, he owns up to his own issues, his own sin, his stuff, his mess. Sometimes we don't want to do that, right? I mean, we want to make our stuff sound less bad. You know, we euphemize him. We make him, doctor him up a little bit so it doesn't sound so bad. You know, it reminds me of the story of the guy who was up. He's going to a family reunion, and he was tasked to do the family tree. So as he's studying their family tree, he realizes that one of his great uncles had murdered somebody and then was sentenced to death and electrocuted, was killed in the electric chair. So he didn't know how to really, he thought, wow, that's going to ruin the family reunion. So he comes up with a different way of saying it. Here's what he said. He says, Uncle Harry occupied a chair of applied electricity at one of our important government institutions. He was attached to his position by the strongest of ties, and his death came as a real shock. So trying to make it seem better than it is, right? I mean, let's just call it what it is. And so often we do that. We minimize, you know, our addictions. I'm not addicted to alcohol. It helps me to relax. I'm not addicted to, I don't have a problem with internet porn. I just like to admire the human body. You know, I don't have a problem with food. I just need the carbs for energy. And I don't like healthy food. I don't like the way it tastes. And I don't have a problem with gossip. I just told one person. You know, I mean, just we minimize what we're doing instead of just owning up, saying, you know what? What I did was wrong. And that's what this guy, the criminal on the cross, does. He owns up to it. He just says, hey, we are not innocent. We're getting what we deserve. This guy, though, he says, you know, he's innocent. It's a different situation. And really, he says to Jesus, he's recognizing who he is. He says, you're holy. He doesn't say those exact words, but he says, this man has done nothing wrong. You know, Matthew and Mark, when they're reporting this, they say both criminals on the cross started out insulting Jesus. But then one changes. And so you wonder, well, here they're both insulting him, throwing insults at him. One changes. So why? Well, I think that if you just, by the reading of the text, you just look at what, here Jesus is for the last 12 hours has been tortured, has been ridiculed, has been humiliated. And what normally somebody does when those things happen is we insult back. We get angry. We get bitter. We get resentful. This is not what Jesus did. We looked at last week. He said, Father, forgive them. He's looking at Jesus' demeanor, the way he's forgiving, and I think it just started rattling him. Thinking, wow, this is not the way a normal person responds. By the way, that's not the way a normal person responds. If you want people to see Jesus in you, when you're insulted, when you're ridiculed, when you're humiliated, when people take advantage of you, you respond the way everybody else responds, then nothing noticeable comes out. But when you respond like Christ and you forgive and you give mercy and you give grace, then people see Christ in that. Because that isn't the way people respond. So this guy, he does a 180. Even the Roman centurion has a change of heart, change of mind. He says, surely this man was the Son of God. The last thing the criminal says on the cross, he actually prays these words to Jesus. He says, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, there's a sign over Jesus' head that was put on there by Pilate that says he's a king, but he doesn't look anything like a king. His face is swollen. His beard's been torn out. Whatever's left of his hair is matted with sweat and blood, and blood's down his all over him, and he's been beaten and scourged with a cat of nine tails. He doesn't even look human, much less a king. Isaiah says this about what the Messiah would look like on the cross. His appearance was disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. But yet this guy looks at him, he goes, I'm trusting you with my future. Remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he just kind of throws himself and says, remember me. Which of these criminals did Jesus die for? Both, right? But both didn't respond. One responds, one doesn't. Now, the last cross is the cross of redemption. It's Jesus' cross. Jesus was in the center. He's the Son of God. He's fully man, fully human. He's fully human, and because of that, he could reach out to the criminal, take his hand, or any other willing sinner, and then with the other hand, reach out to God, and then through his death, he brought them together. He paid the price. And he was able to do that unlike any other person. Here's what Colossians says. It says, at one time, you all had your backs turned to God, thinking rebellious thoughts of him, giving him trouble every chance you got. But now, by giving himself completely at the cross, actually dying for you, Christ brought you over to God's side and put your lives together, whole and holy in his presence. This is what God does. He's, through his son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross, he's drawing humanity back to himself and giving life back to them. Restoring them. This is what's exciting about the gospel. Not just that Jesus Christ died for us, paid for our sins, but he bridged the gap so that we have a place in heaven. And he's restoring us here on earth. He's restoring us, and he gives back life. Life to our finances, life to our health, life to our relationships, life to our marriages. One of the things we'll be talking about at the workshop next weekend, which is Friday and Saturday, for those of you who are, engaged or you're married, it's how to get, like Lance and Heather talked about. When they got married, they didn't put Christ in the center. They were just trying to make it work based on what they saw on TV or what their parents did or whatever. And so this is when we say, let's put Christ in our marriage and see what happens then. So if you've not done that, or maybe, you know, there's probably a lot of you that you would benefit greatly from being part of that workshop. So you'll want to sign up and be part of that. But that's God's mission. He's on mission to bring life into your relationships. Jesus on the cross then makes his one statement. This is the soundbite. Ready for it? Here it is. This is Jesus' soundbite for this week. He says, I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. Now he's talking to this criminal, but he's really talking to everybody. This echoes throughout all eternity. Notice, first thing he says, today. Now the criminal did not ask for that. He just said, hey, just, you know, anytime in the future will work for me. He says, no, today. Today is the day it's going to happen. I've been to heaven. I'm here. I'm going back. You're going to come with me. Today. Not 3 days from now, which he could have said, you know, I rise from the dead 3 days from now. No, or he could have said, you know, 40 days at my ascension. Or maybe next year, I got to work you into my schedule. Or maybe 10,000 years. He could have said, man, you're a criminal. You're going to purgatory. He didn't say that, though. If anybody deserved purgatory, it was this guy, right? This guy's a murderer. He's a mugger. He's lived a life of crime. If anybody had to pay for their sins before they could get to heaven, it would have been somebody like this guy. But he doesn't say that. He doesn't say, well, you got to get baptized first. You got to go to catechism. You got to go to Bible college. He doesn't say any of those things. He says, today. Then he says, you'll be with me. You'll be with me. And that's, you know, you think of heaven. Sometimes we think, well, heaven's clouds and harps. But when I think of home, if I've been away for a while and I come home, I don't go up to my TV and go, I missed you so much, TV. And then I go over to the draperies and like, oh, I miss you, drapes. You know, no, I go to my wife and I hug her and kiss her. I go to my kids and hug them. That's what makes home. And what's going to make heaven great, even though it's cool that there's, you know, pearly gates and crystal sea and golden streets. I mean, that's cool. I'd like to walk on some gold streets, but really I'm looking forward to seeing Jesus. Jesus is what makes heaven special. And he says, today you will be with me in paradise. That word paradise is a transliteration. It's paradiso. So what is paradise? Well, paradise, the Bible talks a lot about paradise. It's heaven. And I put a couple verses there for you. Revelation 2:7 says, to him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So he's speaking to the Ephesian church there, and he says, he's giving them a promise and saying, paradise has the tree of life, where the tree of life is. That's where heaven is. That's where paradise is. And then he says, on each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing its fruit every month. And the leaves are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any more curse. The throne of God will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. He says, that's what heaven's going to be, engaging with God, and we're going to see him face to face. Now, to me, when I'm thinking about Jesus' soundbite, what he said, he's already ministered for 3 years. I wouldn't be surprised if he had already bumped into these guys and talked to them about following him, and they probably shined him on. Hey, whatever, man. And here he is now. We don't know if he had a second chance or not. Certainly people had second chances with God and third chances and fourth chances. And here Jesus is, agony to say a phrase. And he's so impassioned on this guy following him and coming to heaven. One of his seven statements is basically one more for Jesus. One more to follow me. One more, no matter how bad it agonizing, I'm going to say these phrases. It makes me think of a movie that came out recently called Hacksaw Ridge. I want to show you a clip from this. You know, it's based on a true story. Our Andrew Garfield plays the role of Desmond Doss. He's a Virginian, a Medal of Honor hero, who was a pacifist and so went into World War II to fight in the Battle of Okinawa. There's a couple other battles as well, but this, where he got his Medal of Honor was for the Battle of Okinawa, and he was a combat medic. His whole company had gone up a 400-foot cliff, and then there was a tremendous firefight, and a lot of people died. 75 of the men of his company were wounded. They were terribly wounded, bleeding to death. They would die if he didn't rescue them. Everybody else though left because it was so they were being routed. So they left. He was left alone on that cliff at night. He was a Christian and he prayed. He thought, you know what? I can save one. He didn't think in his mind he was going to save a whole bunch, but just one at a time. I can save one. And he would go back into where the fighting was. Because some of these guys were alive. They had a gun and he didn't have a gun because he was a pacifist. And they were protecting him as he was dragging him one by one to the edge of this cliff. And then he had learned as a kid how to do a double bowline knot. And he lowers these guys that are 150, 200, 250 pounds, 400 feet down by himself. 75 men live. He saves 75 men. It messes up his shoulder and his arm so bad that he's permanently disabled after this. But each time he's praying, God, give me strength to save one more. Just a peek into the heart of what was going on with Jesus. When he won more on the cross, he wanted to reach out to this guy. Now, Jesus is really a divider of people. I mean, when his call goes out, not everybody receives Christ. Here's two guys on the cross. Similar situations. Similar crimes, similar thoughts. Yet one refuses, the other repents. The other says, I'm going to take Jesus up on it. And that happens. His call goes out into a marriage, and sometimes one person comes to Christ, the other doesn't. Sometimes in a family we'll see that. One sibling will follow Christ, the other refuses. He divides. Because so much of it depends on our own attitude. As long as we get caught up in trying to do it ourselves, our own, we blame our circumstances, we blame our society, we have excuses for we're the victim. We never come to the place where we say, remember me, save me. So the first, what does it take to really be saved? Well, we see three things from this guy. Three things. Number one is this guy just accepts that he admits he's sinned. He says, don't you fear God since you are under the same sentence? For we are getting what we deserve. He's done with the rationalizations and the excuses. I'm sure he had his list as long as anybody else. Why he was on that cross, the victim, and he didn't deserve it. But he doesn't say that. At this point, he finally says, you know what? I am getting what I deserve. Because I'm not going to compare myself to humanity. I compare myself to a holy God. See, that's scary. It's easy to compare ourselves to others. We look around and we go, well, there's terrorists out there, and there's criminals, and so on a curve, I guess I'm okay. But when we compare ourselves to God who is holy, that gets a little scary, and this is what this guy did. He just said, you know what? I'm getting what I deserve. So he admitted his sin. The second thing we see is him accepting Jesus as Savior. He says, Jesus, remember me. He asks him to save him. And that's it. Recognizing what Christ did on the cross is enough. I don't need to add to it. There's nothing I can do in this life that will make up the moral indebtedness that I owe God. But Jesus did it all. And so we just asked Jesus to save him. But then there's one third thing. And he said, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. He recognizes he was a king. He was a ruler. That God wants to have rulership in our life. It's not enough just to get fire insurance from hell and say, you know what, I got a savior now. No, he wants to be the king, the ruler in our life. And so we recognize, you know, you get divine authority. You call the shots on the decisions I make in life. God actually has a plan for you. You matter to him. You are that one more. God calls to you. He says, you know what? If you are willing to put aside the excuses, put aside all those things, humble yourself and call out to him, God says, I'll be there for you. You'll have a place in heaven, and I'll restore your life. Let's bow our heads and pray. I'm going to invite you to just take a moment now. And just between you and God, this is a moment for you just to say, God, where am I? Honestly, where am I? Am I more like the guy who's still filled with excuses and have my fist raised up and blaming you and blaming everybody? Or am I going to do a 180? The other criminal started out that way, but he changed. So God invites you right now, again, by admitting your sin. Say, God, I've messed up. I haven't always lived for you. I haven't always made the best decisions. I live for myself. Sometimes I've been selfish. Sometimes I've hurt people. Say, God, I have sinned. And then say, thank you for dying for me on the cross. You are my Savior. Would you do that? Just pray right now. Say, God, thank you for dying for me on the cross. It is sufficient. I don't need to add to it. And then here's the big one. This one probably applies to everybody in the room. God, would you be my king? Would you be my ruler? You decide who I date. You decide who I marry. You decide what kind of job I get. You decide how I respond to people who hurt me. And then each one of us, just in your mind, would you just like bow your knee and just say, God, from this day forward, I'm going to, with your help, I want you to be my king. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for listening to this week's message. We hope you enjoyed it. Don't hesitate to write us your story at amen@vineyardchurch.com. And we'll see you next week.